We often went to London, and I'm sure you want to know what kind of transportation took us. Sometimes we'd take the train. Most of the time they would take one of the army trucks, and they would take a group of boys or whoever wanted to go to London, and you'd ride from, I suppose we were what, probably 60 miles north of London. So it was a pretty good ride in a truck, but lots of times you could maybe con somebody that was an officer that you got acquainted with or that they would take you in the cars, which was a much better trip than the truck. Or sometimes the guys would pick you up, two or three guys, and take you in the Jeep. It'll depend, they would go into the MP stations and I suppose give them some orders or take orders from the base that if 92nd Bomb Group soldiers were there, personnel was there, then make sure that they abide by the rules that the Army has put forth for them and let them have a good time, but keep them straight and narrow. And that's how we would get. Lots of times we would take a train, get over to Bedford and then take a train into London. And, it was very nice. Sometimes we get on there, sometimes we'd have to pay and sometimes we wouldn't have to pay because the conductors were very nice to some of the soldiers that got on. It all depends. If you got a pretty nice conductor, he just let you go through. And I probably shouldn't be telling you that because, well, almost all those guys are retired now anyway, so they wouldn't get fired. But most of them are very nice. But normally we could, if we wanted to go to London, they always would have a list that you could sign up on. And they would take you in trucks or whatever, and they would have a designated spot that where you would, and normally it would be at the MP station wherever. Then they had several, around London, because London's not a small town, and you had to be at that same spot. And normally, I always thought that they had their MP stations pretty close to hotels there in London. And I know I can't even remember the one where we went and stayed, but whenever we would go to London, that's where we would stay all the time. Because the MP station was right there, and you got acquainted with the personnel that was operating in stations both day and night. And of course, you could get a little leeway, lenient. You're supposed to be in at 12 o'clock, and maybe you got in a little later than 12 in the morning or whatever. It was nice to have people that you could get acquainted with and know. So that was good for us. Yes, when we would go to London, it was just in fact to go, sometimes we go to the park, Hyde Park, maybe that was the name, I'm not sure. Don't remember some of the names of all the different places, but we go to the park, sit there, because the one hotel was a motel, I guess it was a hotel then, that we were in, was right across from Hyde Park, right by the square. And we normally go to the same place all the time because the people in the hotel got to know you. I knew they know lots of servicemen, because lots of the servicemen did lots of economy for them, and that made it good for them, and it also made it good for, and it was reasonable. I don't know what, of course, we were on the pound system, which was, we had to learn. But it got to be, you almost could do it like you did your own money, a penny, a nickel, a dime, and a quarter, and a half a dollar, and then the bills. So it got to be pretty easy at first. First, when some of the personnel from the service would go over there, they didn't know how to do the money system. Well, what would happen, they would go into the store or wherever they were at or the movie, and they would say, how much is this? And they would say, well, it's so many pence or so many stuff and so many pounds. And so the guys would just take it out and said, take it, how much it would be. And I'm sure they were all honest and they didn't take no more than what they needed on it for. But then you got to learn the system, which was pretty easy after you learned it, got on it, what the coins were, what the bills were and stuff. Matter of fact, I've got down in the basement, I got a 10 shilling note. And that's when dated 1946, no, not 46, but 41, we were there in 44. And I'm sure that bill dated now, well, say 41, look at, that's 59, and add 12 onto it, you got quite a few, 60-some years of one bill that's still laying here in Toledo, Ohio, that I got in England. And I don't know whether how many people brought anything back, but that's what I brought back, and it's downstairs in a box in a plastic thing. I don't know, is it worth anything? I can't tell you all the names that we went when we go around, but Piccadilly, we always call it Piccadilly Circus. To us it was. And of course you could almost see, it was a nice type square. To me, I thought it would almost look like a cul-de-sac. We have at home what a cul-de-sac is a street that goes in, and then you have a turntable at the end of it and come right back out. There's no way to get out except come back out just like you went in. And that's what Piccadilly Square, I always call it, reminded me of. When you look at it, you know, it was complete, but it was more square than it was a circle, you know, but it was a circle in the road. And actually, you could look there and you could see Big Ben. Amazing. And of course, I think everybody wanted to see Big Ben. And then, of course, not only would you look at that, but you would go around, you would go into, I'm trying to think of the name of your main store there, and I can't come up with the name.
Selfridges?
No.
Fortnum & Mason?
Harrods?
Harrods. We used to go into Harrods. And the history behind that was very interesting of how it got to be Harrods, you know. I don't think he was English. No, he was from Iran or Iraq or some of those countries, foreign countries over there. And it was amazing to see Harrods right in middle of London, I always call it, how divisive that a country can be, and they can diversify and not just be their own. They could have both nationalities of everything, which was great for there. You could meet almost anybody that you wanted to there in the square. I'm sure you could. I go sat there, and you know, they had some benches in there. I don't know if they still have any in there. You could go sit and just watch the people. It was amazing just to sit for maybe 25 or 30 minutes and watch the different people, how they dress, how they talk, and especially back then, I thought the English language is supposed to be the top-notch language, which it is, but it was real fast to me and cut off. Because I never forget, I asked the Englishman we were going to go from the square there where we were at, and we wanted to go someplace. I forget even the name where we wanted to go. And it was supposed to be a pub or something that John Houck and them wanted to go in and see. And we said to the guy, can you give us the directions to how to get to this certain place? And the guy was an older Englishman, and I know you folks know that they really talked and chopped off the words. And when the guy got done telling us where the directions at, I couldn't have got out of the square. But it was funny how fast. And then you would talk to a younger person, and they were pretty much just like us, you know. Well, you had your accent and stuff, but then we took their idea how to get to the place. And one time I have to tell you, this is not, we weren't in London, but we were in Bedford, and we got lost. And John Howe, he had a cousin that lived in Bedford. And we were trying to find the street or the area where he was. And it was right off in the main part of the drag where he was supposed to live. And we asked somebody directions. And he said, well, you go down this street, four lamp posts. 1, 2, 3, 4. So we count four lamp posts. And I suppose the lamp post that he was talking about was about a block between on each corner. And then he said, you will make a right and you'll go down one more lamp post. That's the light. And of course, you know, in the evening, those lamp posts were blacked out. They just had the little slits in them. It got pretty dark when you were going. So he was trying to find his cousin. So we get down, we take these four blocks, these four lampposts, and then we took the right and took the one lamppost. And he said, now when you get to that one lamppost, take another right. So okay. So we take that other, we walk and we take that right and go down. And he said, take that other right and you go down to another lamppost. He said, what that was the end of the block. And he said, then make another right. Okay, fine. Now let's see, we take 4, 1, 1. Okay, and then you make a right. Then you come back another lamppost. You've made the right and you come back to another lamppost. I looked at the guy and I said, now wait a minute. You're taking us 4 lampposts down. And you take us 1 down, and take another right, then we're taking another right. Now we're getting back here on the same street that we're on. Now we're here in the middle of the block. You're sending us around this way, and to get back here, why don't you just turn us around and send us down here? Now where are we going? He says it's, when you get to this one, where your street's at, then you make a left and go another lamppost, which is another block. And then you make a left, and it's halfway in the block. I said to him, I said, oh, John Hauck, he's writing all this down. I said, why don't you just turn us around and send us as that first lamppost down there and tell us to take a left and in the middle of the block? Why do you want us to go all the way around the block? He said, I want you to see the scenery. And it's like 8 o'clock at night, and it's dark, and all these little lampposts, these little slits of lights. Now, wasn't that stupid to walk all our way around that and make it stuff? And the guy said, no, he said, I want you to see all the different structures of the buildings and stuff like that. And he was really wiggling out of the thing, and he thought John Hauck knew where his cousin lived. But John didn't know. When he went up to the door, he had to ask, is this so-and-so live here, you know? And they said, yeah. So we went in and met his cousin, and then we were on our way back. But it was so easy just to go that, from where we were standing in the middle of this block, he saw it was crazy. Funny, well, how they were explaining. He wanted to show us a scenic route. But we didn't go that way. We went this way and went in, which was very nice. But that was the directions that we, but you could talk to the younger people. Well, this guy, well, I say it at the time, I said he was old, but he must have been 50 while we were like only 23, 24. So he was old to us, you know. Back when you were a kid, anybody that was 50, getting up to 60, they were old people. Because normally, back in our generation, people didn't live much past 55 and 60. Like my dad, he passed away at 59, you know, and hard worker and all that. But people didn't live to be 90 like they do today. So, but it was great to have the experience of doing all that. Some people say to me, well, why do you remember all that stuff? I said, well, people like to know what you did back then.